Hello, Internet. Seth Skorakowski, and today we're going to talk about villain monologues. A few months back, I did a video about blurters, those players who interrupt whatever's going on. And in that video, I mentioned a neat little gag that the Alexandrians suggested about performing monologues and having initiative be rolled first, and then you do the monologue, and then you perform any actions in the initiative order that was already rolled. Several commenters started focusing on the monologues themselves out of that whole freaking video, saying that how much they hated monologues and that they were appalled I would even recommend them. But that video wasn't about my opinion of monologues, it was merely me passing on a cool suggestion to any game masters out there who like them and want to use them. And if they and their table like monologues, then great, have fun. Personally, I'm not a big fan of them myself, so that's what we're going to talk about. What monologues are, how to effectively use them, and why I don't use them myself at our table. Now, this video is going to be system neutral, so it makes no difference if you're playing D&D, Alien, Call of Cthulhu, Traveler, or whatever else, the same general concepts apply to all tabletop role-playing games. First, let's discuss what they are. Monologues in tabletop role-playing games are exposition by the bad guy. Now, this can be self-reflective, self-congratulatory, mocking, intended to manipulate or persuade the PCs, but a lot of game masters tend to use monologues as info dumps, revealing the bad guy's evil plans or motivation, or simply make sense of the adventure as they explain how all these seemingly unrelated things are all part of the villain's master brilliant scheme. Perez laughs. You thought you killed Sarah? That was only a double. Sarah is safe with me.
What?
Aw, damn. And that bomb at the warehouse was only a distraction to destroy my secret lab.
That makes so much sense now.
And that shipment of grain that you protected? Ha! My data cores were hidden inside those crates and you brought them right to me.
Damn, what a twist.
And now with the data cores in place, Sarah's ready to be upgraded into my ultimate weapon.
Everything makes total sense now.
Personally, I don't use these types of monologues. I prefer more investigative games where the player characters, and more importantly, the players, have the opportunity to piece all that stuff together themselves before any final confrontation with the bad guy. And I feel it's just a lot more rewarding if they solve all that on their own rather than requiring that I have to outright tell them through the monologue as the bad guy. But I believe that a lot of game masters are expecting it to be some sort of big dramatic reveal, just like in their favorite TV shows or movies. Unfortunately, it doesn't really end up that way that much. Usually it ends up like,
kicking open the door, you step into the chamber. The evil Baron whirls around to face you, the rod of Theodrum glowing in his hands. Fools, he says. You thought you killed Sarah, but she was only a...
I'm going to cast Silence on him.
What?
I'm going to shoot him in the face with my crossbow before he can attack us.
But my monologue...
Sorry, brother, but we gotta take this opportunity to get him before he can get us.
And then the game master goes online and they complain about how much their players are a bunch of murder hobos and wouldn't let them have their sweet monologue that they wanted, which, okay, maybe their players are murder hobos, but that's completely unrelated. That's not the reason that the monologue failed. So, why do monologues fail? There could be several reasons for this. For one, monologues feel about 10 times longer for the player than it does for the game master that's delivering it. But the big reason that monologues often fail is that the upper hand hasn't clearly been established before the monologue begins. So the players, make their move to take control of the situation before the bad guy can do that. And that is a completely logical thing for them to do. I mean, why wouldn't they do that? So look at many of those famous monologues in cinema, the same ones that the game masters are often trying to emulate, but those game masters fail to recognize one crucial piece, that one side usually has a clear upper hand established before the monologue even begins. Maybe the bad guys have the upper hand. The Joker in The Dark Knight, his famous monologue about schemers and plans, is delivered to Harvey Dent while Dent is tied to a hospital bed, unable to act until the Joker allows it. Thulsa Doom and Conan in a speech about the Riddle of Steel, Conan is beaten down, flanked by guards, and helpless to do anything as the bad guy talks. Roy Batty's wonderful Tears in the Rain monologue in Blade Runner is delivered as Harrison Ford has been beaten down and weaponless. Technically, he's already lost this fight. He fell off a roof and was only alive because Roy saved him. So in a tabletop role-playing game, he'd be considered to be in an incapacitated state here. Darth Vader's infamous reveal that he's Luke's father. Luke is cornered, has no lightsaber, and no freaking hand. Vader clearly has the upper hand here, and he took this moment to give his big reveal. Agent Smith in The Matrix saying how humanity is a virus and he wants out. Morpheus is drugged and handcuffed to a steel chair as he's delivering it. So game masters that are trying to reproduce these moments need to first capture, disarm, or incapacitate the player characters. The reason that the bad guy is monologuing to them is because the bad guy knows that they're safe. The reason that the hero isn't attacking them is because they can't attack the bad guy right now. If both the hero and the villain were on equal playing fields, the monologue couldn't have happened. Now, sometimes the hero has the upper hand, and they feel safe letting the bad guy talk to them, such as they've already captured the bad guy, and now they're interrogating them for information. In Alien, Ash is nothing more than a severed head when he tells Ripley and company why he betrayed everybody and what their chances are. Before he was defeated, Ash didn't want to talk. All he wanted to do was kill. His informational monologue was the reward for defeating him. Raiders of the Lost Ark, Indy allows Belloc to deliver his fly-eating monologue about passing through history because Indy is holding a rocket launcher on the Ark at that moment. He's technically got the upper hand here. It can also be that the villain believes that they have the upper hand, but the player characters are merely wanting the villain to confess, such as they might be wearing a wire and need to get the bad guy's confession to clear their own name or be legally allowed to act against the bad guy here. A Few Good Men, Jack Nicholson's famous "You Can't Handle the Truth" monologue was delivered in a courtroom as Nicholson's character believed that his high rank would protect him until he was eventually goaded into this confession. Another way that a villain might deliver that important information without the player characters interrupting it is the heroes are merely eavesdropping on the bad guy. In Goldfinger, the villain explains his evil plot to all his minions, complete with a super sweet model that rises up out of the floor, completely unaware that Bond is hiding and observing it all from beneath it, you know, from inside the model. Another way game masters can safely allow their bad guy to taunt or share their evil plan with the player characters is that they're not actually there at the time, such as they're on a video screen or on a hologram or a magic mirror. You know, they could be like Sky Captain the World of Tomorrow, where they're facing an interactive recording of the bad guy monologuing. That gives you a great chance to deliver your evil monologue with zero risk of the player characters interrupting and killing your bad guy before you're ready for them to face off against the bad guy later on. As I said, I personally don't use villain monologues myself. I prefer the heroes to have already pieced together all the plot themselves, and you know, I just assume that when the player characters do have their big confrontation with the bad guy, that the player characters are just going to attack them. Now, maybe they might ask for confirmation of what they already know, or that little last piece of information they lack, you know, just one question before I kill you sort of thing. But in all honesty, if the upper hand hasn't been established before the player characters walk into the room, don't plan for the bad guy to have a monologue. If the bad guy's motivation wasn't already clear, at most expect one or two sentences before the bullets and fireballs start flying. Kicking open the door, you step into the altar room. Professor Graves wheels around. "Stop! I'm trying to save my wife!" What do you do? If the PCs wish to know more, they can ask for more. You know, it feels better for this to be their decision to ask, but expect them to just to attack and kill the bad guy. Just expect it. Now, maybe they'll surprise you and talk to the bad guy first, and one way to help encourage this, the player characters talking to the bad guy, is to tell your players that if they want more information, such as why all this is happening in the first place, it is their choice to talk or fight.
"Stop! I'm trying to save my wife!"
What do you do?
I raise my shotgun and I shoot him in the face.
"Wait a second, I want to know how this is going to save his wife."
If you want to know that, this is your chance right here.
Let him weasel out of justice and try to get us back? No way. I hit him in the face for 16 points of damage. His head explodes, splattering brains all over the wall behind him as his body just collapses at the foot of the altar.
Damn, now we're never going to know why I burned down the observatory.
Yeah, doesn't look like you will.
Now, I would love to say that I have never once done a villain monologue, but while I was compiling my thoughts on this subject, I remember that I want the one that I did years and years ago, and I can't even recall what the plot of the adventure was or what game we were even playing at the time. It was probably AD&D, but I do remember the monologue incident. I knew coming in that I would only get a couple sentences in, just a sentence or two before the player character is attacked, so I mainly prepared a monologue to myself. I didn't write any of this down because I wanted to come out natural versus scripted,
but I'm mainly prepared at maybe a minute of talking before the with all the important information just up front in that, with, you know, a little bit more as padding that, you know, hopefully I could burn through before the player character is attacked. But I came in thinking it was only going to get a second or two, but I did have a few ideas for more that could happen after that minute, but figured I would never get to say that. So I sort of treated it like what the bad guy planned to say to the player characters before the player characters interrupted and killed them. So the game rolls around, the player characters confront the bad guy, and I begin my monologue, and the players don't interrupt me. They're paying attention to what I'm saying. So I finished everything that I'd rehearsed and now sort of bumbling through that other stuff that I'd vaguely outlined, and I'm beginning to panic because I just assumed that they would cut me off, and, you know, this eloquent speech is now devolving into this clumsy rambling. And finally I'm like, "So guys, what you doing while he's talking all this stuff at you?" "We're just waiting for you to finish." "Yeah, with enjoying it." "Oh, well, I've just been waiting for you guys to interrupt and attack me." "Oh, well, in my case, I'm going to shoot him in the face." That day, I learned a valuable lesson that the players will never, ever do what you assume for them to do. And I have no doubts that if I had pre-prepared some giant 3-minute gripping speech, that they'd have just opened fire on me in the first 10 seconds there. So the fact that I expected them to cut me off ended up being why they listened to me as long as they did. Now, personally, what I prefer far more than a monologue while the players are just sitting there and listening to the game master talk is having a back and forth conversation, a dialogue that they participate in and that we can roleplay ourselves through. Now, this is one that I have done several times, and the success rate on this has been pretty freaking high here. Now, they can follow along all the same steps as a monologue has, such as the bad guy has the upper hand, or they're on a giant wall screen, or the hero has the upper hand and is interrogating them. And while they usually still end with a big fight and confrontation, the players have their say on how long this goes and how actively involved they are during this, so they remember back on it fondly and often as being the highlight of the game. And while sure, they often end up with the player characters, you know, sucker punching and attacking the bad guy once they feel that this conversation has run its course, you know, if they ain't buying what the bad guy is selling, I as the game master have always felt that all the important information that I wanted to deliver was imparted before that fight begins. Anyway, that is my thought on monologues. I'm not a fan of them personally, but I understand that some people out there like them. However, any game masters that are wanting to do monologues should always remember that first, keep it short, very short, shorter. And second, try to establish it so that one party or the other has a clear upper hand to allow your player characters to allow you to have this monologue in the first place. Again, people are always referring to all the different famous ones out of films and TV shows, but they forget to acknowledge the setup and the situation that allowed that monologue to happen in the first place. But in the end, I feel it's far more rewarding and fun for everybody in the room if the players can figure out the plot by themselves without requiring the bad guy explain it all to them. And it's also just far more enjoyable if it's presented as a back and forth dialogue instead of the players just listening to the game master speak to them for an indeterminate amount of time before they're allowed to act. Because in the end, the game master's priority should be that the players have a wonderful experience and not the players just be reduced to an audience that's sitting there captive watching the game master display their own glory as a storyteller or an actor. And it's just far more fun for everybody around the table if we're all involved and we're all role-playing. Hey, thanks for watching. If you enjoyed the video, please give it a thumbs up. If you want to see some more of our stuff, such as game reviews, how-tos, just hit that subscribe button. If you want to support Seth's channel, consider picking up one of his books or novels available in print or ebook or audiobook, and who knows, maybe you'll even enjoy it. Till next time, amigos. Y'all have a great day. You know, for a guy that says he don't like doing monologues, you make some seriously long videos.